Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, accompanied by Grambling State University President, Dr. Steve Favors.
Good morning.
Good morning.
On behalf of the faculty, students, staff, and administration of Grambling State University and the Board of Supervisors of the University of Louisiana System, I want to welcome the graduates, their families, and friends, supporters, and alumni who are gathered here today to celebrate this significant and momentous occasion. Please remain standing for the national anthem. We will now have the invocation by Reverend E. Edward Jones, President, National Baptist Convention of America, and Pastor of Galilee Missionary Baptist Church, Shreveport, Louisiana.
Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. And we thank you for that demonstration of your word today, for here in the backwoods of Louisiana, you have promised that you would allow our gifts to bring us before great men. O Lord, we thank you. And we praise your holy name. We thank you for this hallowed place, Grambling State University. Our prayer, join the thousands of other prayers prayed across the expanse of years for these young people who graduate today. We pray your blessings upon these students, these graduates, this faculty, this administration. We ask your continued favor on President Favors as he seeks to escalate the height of influence foundation by the founder of this institution, Charles P. Adams, cemented by Dr. Ralph Waldo Emerson Jones, both who today smile from heaven. We thank you for Drs. Joseph Johnson, Harold Lundy, and Raymond Hicks, who have made up the line of procession of presidents. Through the years, you have blessed this school. So we offer you our thanks and our praise, and especially those of us who are alumni, we have a special stake in this 1999 graduation. We especially thank you for the vision today of President Favors for inviting the chief executive of our nation to be the commencement speaker, the Honorable President William Jefferson Bill Clinton. We thank you, God, for Dr. Favors. We thank you today for President Clinton. Thank you, Lord, for Hope, Arkansas, and for hope for such a time as this. We thank you that you have blessed us to gather here in Robinson Stadium, families and friends of thousands of people today who have known the struggles of the past, and today it's almost unbelievable. So we thank you for your graciousness and for the demonstration of your power. We pray today for our Commander-in-Chief as he deals with so many problems. Help us to pray for him on a daily basis and many times a day as he deals with both domestic and foreign policies. Hold him in the hollow of your hand as he carries this nation into the new millennium. Give him power to wrestle with the problems of Yugoslavia, Kosovo, China, and all of the nations that are troubled. We have seen and now know that Hope, Arkansas was ordained for this day in our time by seeing some of our hopes and aspirations being fulfilled through your servant, William Bill Clinton. Lord, now what wait I for? My hope is in thee. So let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. We have selected a few individuals to bring greetings, and I'm going to call to the podium Mayor of Grambling State, of the City of Grambling, Mayor Williams. Please come forward.
President William Jefferson Clinton, President of the greatest nation in the world, it is indeed an opportunity to welcome you here today. But above all, I would like to congratulate the graduates of this particular class. I would like to welcome all of our friends, neighbors, and contributors to Grambling State University, and all of the persons who are interested in our progress. It's indeed a pleasure to know that we have this many people doing things to foster the future of this university. To the Board of Trustees and all of the governmental officials in Louisiana and Washington, we certainly appreciate this opportunity, and we look forward to working with you to make this a better place and make it a better America. Thank you.
Next, we have the president of the University of Louisiana System, Mr. Bobby Jindal.
On the behalf of the University of Louisiana System, certainly I'd like to extend my invitation and thanks to the president for joining us. But most importantly, I'd like to express to the students our pride in your accomplishments. I'd like to address the students, this class of 99, by saying, you've made us proud, you've made your parents proud, you've made the faculty here proud. We know that you take a little piece of Grambling with you wherever you go after today. We ask you to continue making us proud, and please continue to remember Grambling State University as you move on from here today. Congratulations, class of 99.
Next, we'll have remarks from Tony Eason, outgoing president of the Grambling University Student Government Association.
A university is a human invention for the transmission of knowledge and culture for the generation to generation. For we are the last generation of the century at Grambling State University. We must ensure that the transmission of knowledge continue by giving back to our institution by financial, physical, and spiritual. But for it matters not how straight the gate, how charged the punishment the scroll, you are the master of your fate and the captain of your soul. Welcome to Grambling State University. Friends, faculty, staff, administrators, the class of 1999, our special guest, the 42nd President, William Jefferson Clinton, welcome.
Ms. Martha Fundell, Miss Grambling State University for 1998-99.
A famous speaker once said, if it is to be, then it's up to me. M-E, maximum efficiency, being the best that only I can be, while changing the world positively. We, the students here at Grambling State University, are the best. We are the best because we give our best. And because we give our best, we graduate only the best. Good morning to our platform guest, Dr. Favors, President Clinton, fellow Gramblingites, visitors, and friends. Welcome to Grambling State University, where our motto is the place where everybody is somebody. We believe in taking diamonds in the rough and polishing them into the illustrious leaders of America. This morning, we will present to you over 400 diamonds polished to their finest luster. This is the day that the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad. Again, welcome to Grambling State University.
Hey, Glenn. This side of it is in these pictures. Next, we have a special tribute to President Clinton from the Grambling State University Marching Band under the direction of Dr. Larry Pinnell.
Get ready, President William Jefferson Clinton, for at commencement 99 here at Grambling State University. In this, the legendary Eddie G. Robinson Stadium, the world-famous Grambling State University Tiger Marching Band presents a tribute. Yes, for the magic that you bring here today, President Clinton, the band would like to pay tribute to your musicianship as a saxophonist, as we feature our saxophonist with a song entitled Mr. Magic, made popular by jazz saxophonist Mr. Grover Washington, Jr.
Dr. Neri Warner, would you please join me in introducing our speaker by reading our citation of some of the achievements and accomplishments that have earned him honor and distinction by Grambling State University. President Bill Clinton, would you please stand?
William Jefferson Clinton, a graduate of Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., and of Yale University School of Law, a Rhodes Scholar, a teacher of law at the University of Arkansas at Fayetteville, governor of Arkansas and the youngest governor of the United States, and the 42nd president of these United States, we honor you today and thank you for your proven commitment to quality education and to the development of the common good across racial lines. Throughout your public life, you have worked to make a difference in the lives of others and have created opportunities for people to fulfill their dreams. We honor you for your commitment to technology. As you have authorized an increase in funding from $23 million to $698 million to provide educational technology and low-cost internet connections for all schools and libraries in the entire United States by the year 2000. We honor you for your presidential initiative on race that promotes racial reconciliation through programs that increase awareness of racial issues, that improves the lives of individuals who are affected by past and present discrimination, that encourages colleges and universities to partner with professional organizations and agencies to conduct special programs focusing on race and diversity in this American society, that helps to eliminate racial prejudice and discrimination from workplaces, schools, and retail institutions, and that seeks the commitment of students in high schools and in colleges to commit to projects that move the country closer together. We honor you for increasing African American participation in this American government. Through your presidential appointments of 3 African Americans on the cabinet, twice as many African American presidential appointments as any previous administration, 14 African American U.S. attorneys, and 12 African American U.S. marshals. We honor you for your proven support of historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs, as demonstrated by your signing of Executive Order 12876 on November 1, 1993, which established an advisory board on historically black colleges and universities and created the White House Initiative on Historically Black Colleges and Universities, which is designed to advance the development of human potential, to strengthen the capacity for historically black colleges and universities to provide quality education, and to increase opportunities for them to participate in and to benefit from federal programs, which have helped historically black colleges and universities to receive an unprecedented 25% increase in federal funding dollars. We honor you for the solid fiscal leadership you have provided for the nation, as evidenced by the lowest unemployment rate in modern times. And we applaud you for increasing hourly wages, which aided in improving the quality of life for all Americans, particularly for the marginalized groups in our society.
It is therefore with immense pleasure and pride that Grambling State University, with the approval of the Board of Supervisors for the University of Louisiana system, confers upon you the Doctors of Laws degrees. I'm going to ask Coach Eddie Robinson to come and assist us in the robing of the president. Without any further delay, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the newest member of the Grambling State University family, Dr. Bill Clinton, President of the United States.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. I thank you for the wonderful, wonderful welcome. President Favors, thank you for the degree. I'm beginning to feel smarter already. To my good friend, Reverend Jones, thank you for your wonderful invocation and reminding us why we are here on this Lord's Day. Mayor Williams, thank you for making me feel welcome, and I thank the other mayors and council members who met me. Dr. Jindal, and thank you for your remarks. I must say I was especially impressed by the remarks of your student government president, Tony Eason, and Miss Grambling, Martha Fondell. After they spoke, I wasn't quite sure I wanted to give my speech. Let me also say that I am delighted to be joined today by your distinguished Senator Mary Landrieu and Congressman William Jefferson from New Orleans. By our Secretary of Transportation, and like me, a neighbor of yours to the north from Arkansas, Secretary Rodney Slater. I thank him. You know, when I heard that I might be able to come to Grambling, there was very little discussion about this in the White House. Now, usually when the president has a chance to go someplace, there's always an argument about it because they think you should be somewhere else. Somebody who works for you thinks you should be somewhere else. But I told my staff that I wanted to take a day away from Washington, D.C. Now, Washington is a town where everybody thinks they're somebody. And I wanted to come to the place where everybody is somebody. I also was not about to miss a chance to hear the best band in the land. And I thank you for the musical tribute. And I'm glad at least the tuba players were standing up and dancing. I would have missed that too. Hey, I'm just getting warmed up. Come on. To the last Grambling class of the 20th century, this is an important day in your lives. In so many ways, well, you'll be able to get one now. In so many ways, the story of this institution embodies the whole 20th century's experience of African Americans. In 1901, not a single public school in this part of Louisiana would welcome an African American into its classes. But the visionary farmers of this community, the children and grandchildren of slaves, were determined to give their children the education and pride and power to rise above bigotry and injustice. And so, even though they didn't have much, they scrounged around and raised some money and wrote a letter to Booker T. Washington asking him to send a teacher to help build a school in the Piney Woods. Out of that determination, Grambling has truly grown into a university for the 21st century. You have nurtured some of our nation's best educators and lawyers, pastors and public servants, nurses and business leaders. Of course, the NFL recruits here, thanks to Eddie Robinson and his successor, Super Bowl MVP Doug Williams. Of course, you're known for your band and your other athletic teams, but America's top technology firms recruit here too, because Grambling confers more computer and information science degrees to African Americans than any other university in the nation. So you join a proud tradition today, and I congratulate you all. You have gained knowledge that will enrich you for the rest of your lives, and I can just see by looking at you, you've made friends who will stay with you for the rest of your lives. Through long hours in the class and late nights in the library, through moments of both self-doubt and triumph, you have today gained the prize, an education that will help you succeed in one of the most exciting eras in all of human history. I'd also like to congratulate and honor today your parents, your grandparents, your aunts and uncles. All those who had a hand in raising you. They should be proud of you, but they should also be proud of themselves. To raise a child from infancy to college graduate is no small feat. You hear the amens from the audience on that one. One of the most beloved presidents of Grambling, Ralph Waldo Emerson Jones, I understand, often said to his students, "When you go home, be sure to kiss everybody, including the mule, because the mule is the one who pulls the plow and keeps the family going." Well, I'm not going to ask the graduates to kiss any mules today, but I do ask each of you, before this day is over, to say a special thank you to the people who kept your families going. I asked for some research on some of the families. I'd just like to mention two. People like Joyce Gaines of Vallejo, California. Listen to this. Even through the pain of 5 ruptured discs in her back, she worked 3 jobs and commuted 200 miles a day to put her daughter, Taisha, through Grambling. Where are you? Stand up there. Today, she's graduating with a degree in sociology, and she plans to open a home for abused children. She is a tribute to her mother's love and sacrifice. We thank you. People like James and Lily Bedford of Shreveport. James is a plumber, Lily is a cook. Both took on extra work at night and on weekends to help their youngest son, Terrence, pay for college. She was a student at Grambling back in the 50s, but Lily had to leave before graduating. Now, Terrence is the second of the 7 Bedford children to earn a Grambling degree, and he's the senior class president. Congratulations to the Bedfords. Where are you? Thank you. Stories like this remind us of what people can achieve when they set their minds to it, but they also remind us of how hard it can be to raise a child right, especially today in our very busy society with its very demanding economy. Now, this is a serious part of the talk, and I want you to have a good time today, but I want you to listen to this. This spring, I'm going to speak to seniors about how this new economy is transforming every aspect of our lives. Next month at the University of Chicago, I'll talk about how we must put a human face on the dynamic but often disruptive international marketplace. But today, I want to talk to you about what we as a nation must do to help families like those I just mentioned. And those will be your families, master the challenges of the new economy. I've been thinking a lot about family lately, and I expect a lot of you have. In the aftermath of the terrible tragedy at Littleton and the other school shootings we've had in our country, they forced us to confront the need not only to make guns less available to criminals and children, not only to make our culture less violent and our schools safer, but also to make the bonds that tie parents to children stronger. The spate of hate crimes that we have seen, taking the lives of James Byrd Jr. in Texas, Matthew Shepard in Wyoming, and others, forces to confront the need to raise our children to respect others who are different from themselves. And to recognize that all hardworking, law-abiding people are part of our national family. The horrible ethnic cleansing of this decade in Bosnia, then Rwanda, now Kosovo, demonstrate in stark terms what can happen when a people raise their children without the fundamental premise embodied in our Declaration of Independence, that we are all created equal, equally endowed by God with the right to life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. It all begins with family. With parents who love their children more than life and raise them to live their dreams. Most of you today are probably thinking more about the adventures of the work that awaits you at this marvelous time in your lives. And well, you should be. But most of you also will become parents. When that happens, it will be the most important work you will ever do. You will have the awesome responsibility of your children's physical, intellectual, emotional, and spiritual development, while at the same time pursuing your own lives in a society that will reward your knowledge and skills, empower and entertain you with its explosions of technology and mobility, and keep you very, very busy. For those without your level of education, in your time, just earning enough to pay the bills may be a chore, especially if there are children to be raised. Now, the class of 1999 is entering an era of unparalleled opportunity and possibility, with, for example, the lowest African-American unemployment and poverty rates ever recorded and the highest African-American homeownership in history. To give more people like you a chance to participate fully in this economy, we've opened the doors of college to more and more Americans with the Hope Scholarship Tax Credit, larger Pell Grants, lower cost student loans, tools many of you have used to finance your education. Now, with your diplomas in hand, you will have the chance to reap the benefits and shape the future of this new era, your time. To lead lives of greater accomplishment and affluence than most of your parents even dreamed of. But as you form your own families, you will no doubt feel the pressure of trying to balance the demands of work and family. And doing a good job at both in a world that moves faster and faster and often leaves parents less and less time and energy for their children. Today's working parents too often feel enormous stress and bring the stress home with them. This is a problem not confined. I want to emphasize this to you. It is not confined just to people who work for low and modest incomes. Most of the parents I know have had problems balancing work and family. And as you move through your careers, unless we act now, this problem will get worse. Therefore, I believe it is imperative that your country give you the tools to succeed not only in the workplace, but also at home. If you or any American has to choose between being a good parent and successful in your careers, you have paid a terrible price, and so has your country. I asked the President's Council of Economic Advisors to study the sweeping changes the modern economy has brought to our families. Now, no offense to anybody on the faculty here, but you know it's been said that if every economist on earth were laid end to end, they still would not reach a conclusion. But on this question, these economists did reach a conclusion, one that conforms to common sense and common experience. They found that because more and more parents were working outside the home, they have less and less time for their children. The percentage of married mothers in the workforce has nearly doubled in a generation, from 38% in 1969 to 68% in 1996. Because more mothers are working outside the home and because the number of single parent families has grown, listen to this, because this will be your life. Parents in the average family now have 22 fewer hours each week to spend at home. That's nearly one full day less time per week for parents to devote for their children. That means by the time a child reaches the age of 18 in today's world, those 22 hours a week amount to over 2 years more the parents are away from home. We as a nation must find a way to give your generation of parents some of that time back, even as you've gotten an education to succeed in the workforce. Now, most of today's parents, the vast majority, are doing everything they can to do right by their kids, but they still worry that no matter how hard they try, it won't be enough. They worry that waking up early and staying up late to make time for their children may not be enough, when a child still has to come home to an empty house after school. They worry that all those Sunday morning sermons about a world of love might not be enough, when TV and movies their children watch, the music they listen to, the video games they play, show too much hate and violence. They worry that all those nights working overtime to buy a computer so that a child can visit some of the world's finest libraries on the internet might not be enough, when the same internet can also lead them to recipes for pipe bombs and explosives, or to website discussions of dark visions of life and society so very different from the ones the parents have tried to impart. Last week, Hillary and I took a sad journey to Colorado to visit with the students and the families of Columbine High School. I came away from that experience more certain than ever that as we work to strengthen our gun laws, we also have to work to strengthen our families. Now, it seems to me that the modern economy you're going to be a part of poses four great challenges for you as parents. The greatest and most obvious, as I've said, is time. In our round-the-world, round-the-clock economy, there just don't seem to be enough hours in the day for parents to do everything they need to do. I'm proud that the first bill I signed as president was the Family and Medical Leave Act, and since 1993, millions of Americans have used it to take up to 12 weeks of unpaid leave to care for a newborn or a sick relative without losing their jobs. It has been a great thing. But to be truthful, the current law just meets a fraction of the need. Too many people, too many family obligations aren't covered at all. Too many families can't take advantage of the law because they can't afford to take the time off because they can't live without their paychecks. For all of this nation's pro-family rhetoric, the hard truth is that other countries with advanced economies do a lot more to support working parents than we do. We must think bigger and do better. On the eve of the 21st century, we ought to set a goal that all working Americans can take time when they need it to care for their families without losing the income they need to support their families. Achieving that goal cannot come overnight and will require a significant shift in how our nation helps families to succeed at home and work, but it can make all the difference in your lives. It will demand thought and creativity, a willingness to experiment. It has to be done in a way that gives families flexibility and doesn't undermine our dynamic and growing economy. Today, using my executive authority as president, we're going to take an important step toward that goal. I am directing the Office of Personnel Management, whose director, Janice LaChance, came down here with me today, to allow all federal workers to use the sick leave they've earned to take time off to care for other sick family members. Now, what this means is, on sick leave, you get paid. Currently, the most sick leave a worker can use in these kinds of cases is 13 days a year. With the new policy I propose today, federal employees will be able to take up to 12 weeks paid sick leave to nurse an ailing child or parent back to health. If every company in America that offers sick leave to its workers adopted the same policy we're adopting today, half of all the American workforce would have this important benefit for their families. We have to find other creative ways to help Americans use benefits they've worked for to finance the time off they need for their families. Let me give you another example. A few states have asked the federal government if it would be possible to try a bold idea. Allow workers who have earned unemployment insurance coverage to collect unemployment payments while they're on leave caring for a newborn or a newly adopted child. This is a very promising idea. Today, I'm directing the Secretary of Labor to issue a rule to allow states to offer paid leave to new mothers and fathers. We can do this in a way that preserves the soundness of the unemployment insurance system and continues to promote economic growth. But as the First Lady said in her book, It Takes a Village, those first weeks of life are critical to the bonding of parents and children, and they can have long-term positive developments for the children. No parent should have to miss them. I also am challenging Congress to help. I have proposed expanding unpaid family leave to cover more workers and more parental responsibilities, and Congress ought to respond positively. Parents should not have to fear a boss's wrath because they left work to take a child to the doctor. They shouldn't have to call in sick to attend a parent-teacher conference at the school. The second challenge parents face is finding affordable, high-quality child care, and a lot of you will face that. Low-income families spend up to a quarter of their income on child care. Studies show that only 1 in 7 child care centers meet all the standards of good quality. Now, I'm supporting subsidies for child care and tax credits, better training for caregivers, stronger enforcement of safety centers standards, and I want business to do more by helping their own workers find and afford quality child care. In addition to that, you know, today millions of working parents, and a lot of them right here in North Louisiana, start looking at the clock every day about 3 p.m, wondering if their kids have come home from school, wondering how they'll fare at home alone. The hours after the school bell rings and before parents come home are a perilous time for children, the time they're most tempted to try drugs and alcohol, most likely to become victims of a crime. That's why I have asked Congress to triple our investment in quality after-school programs. I challenge school districts all across this country. Unlock those empty classrooms in the late afternoon. Fill them with the sounds of children playing and learning. The third challenge parents face, since they're more and more at work, is that they're literally physically apart from their children more. Now, because of some modern developments in the workforce, we can actually close that distance by bringing back a very old idea: letting children who can be with their parents more at work. When I was a young child, I often went to work with my grandfather, who worked as a night watchman in a sawmill outside Hope, Arkansas. And I often went to the little grocery store he ran. And I tried not to be in the way too much or to eat too many cookies that I didn't pay for. But I learned lessons there that have stayed with me for the rest of my life. As I became president, I realized that as a father with a daughter who was then still in junior high school, I had the privilege of, in effect, living above the store. The place where I worked was only a 2 or 3 minute walk to have dinner every night with my family. When I was governor, I still remember when I was governor, I had a little desk over in the corner of my office for my daughter, and I still have vivid memories. I'd be at my desk, she'd be at hers with her crayons drawing me little pictures. Now, because of changes in the workforce, we can't do this for everybody, but we can do it for more. More of America's employers can use technology to bring workers and children closer together by allowing more employees to telecommute at work, that is, work at home with a modem where it's feasible. More employers can open more on-site childcare centers, and I have seen them working very well in this country. I support tax breaks to help them afford to do that. More employers can team up with school districts to build public schools at work sites if they're large enough. Dozens of companies have already built innovative public schools. That's what you've done here at Grambling. That's what the lab school is, isn't it? It's a school at a work site, especially friendly to education. These are good things to do, and I challenge the employers of this country to look at them closely. Finally, the last great challenge parents face in the modern economy is cultural. The new economy has enriched our lives with lower-priced electronic gear and a growing variety of media entertainment, and it sure is interesting. But too often, TV, radio, the internet bombard our children with images and ideas that no parent would ever want them to see. We need tools to protect free speech and give parents more control over what their young children see, hear, and read. Under the leadership of Vice President Gore, those tools are now being crafted. Soon, half of all the TV sets sold in our country will come with V-chips, so parents can basically make the most of the new TV rating systems. These devices enable parents to screen out violence, sex, or any program they don't want their children to see. Soon, with just a click of a mouse, parents who have the courage to learn how to use a computer will be able to take offensive websites off their children's screens. The entertainment industry must also do its part. They should stop showing guns and violence and ads children can't see when they can't see the movies in the first place. They should enforce the movie rating system more strictly, and they ought to re-examine that rating system to see whether it's too loose when it comes to giving a PG-13 rating to films full of gratuitous violence. These are tools that can help working parents succeed at the most important job you'll ever have, raising children. The government's responsibility is to make tools available. Your responsibility is to use them. Dr. King once wrote, "It is quite easy for me to think of a God of love, mainly because I grew up in a family where love was central and loving relationships were ever present. I hope and pray that the class of 1999 will have the chance to build those ever-present loving relationships with your children. To raise your children well, you will have to make many sacrifices. But then, as we learned again today, and as you showed by your applause for them, your parents made many for you. I ask you to think one more time about how you got here today to be sitting in the hot sun." I'm sort of sorry I'm in the shade. I ought to be in the sun and you ought to be in the shade since I'm talking. But think about this. How many of you would be here today if it weren't for one or more people in your families who were reading to you or telling you stories when you were little, who were helping with your homework, who were attending your school events, even if they were dog-tired after work, imparting wisdom over dinner, working with you to give chances they didn't have, giving you that unconditional love, support, and faith that says, "You are the most important person in the world to me." Your parents have worked and sacrificed. If you ask them today, was it worth it? You know what they would say. Until But until you watch your own children grow up, you can't really know how proud your parents are of you today and how sure they are that all the sacrifices were more than worth it. No matter what else you accomplish in life, and many of you will accomplish a very great deal, your children will still matter most. We have to make sure that you and they get all the benefits of this fabulous modern world and still keep the enduring gift of your devotion and love. As you journey into the new millennium, I wish you success and fulfillment at work and with your children. Congratulations, good luck, and God bless you.
In Texarkana, Texas, or 44 miles from your hometown of Hope, Arkansas. Like you, I moved to Washington, D.C. to work. Like you also, I worked there for 8 years, or in your case, two terms. In a short time, you will be leaving office. When you leave, you will have a number of career opportunities to choose from. No doubt you will receive offers to teach or work at some of the most prestigious academic or flagship universities in this country and the world. I'm certain without a doubt that they will be able to offer you a substantial financial package that we could only dream about. Nevertheless, I want to extend another invitation to you to come back to Grambling. As a member of our faculty. If you accept this invitation, I promise that we will provide you with all the gumbo, jambalaya, crawfish, hot water, cornbread, collard greens, sweet potato pie and ham that you can eat in a very hospitable environment. We'll even allow you unlimited opportunities to play the saxophone with the world-renowned Grambling State Marching Band. But seriously, you would be doing a great thing for a great institution. Institutions like Grambling have never been able to enjoy the privileges or the benefits of having a President of the United States become a member of our faculty. Even if you can only do it for a week, or two, we would be proud to have you. We ask you to think about it, take your time, and get back to us whenever you feel the need is appropriate. Next, we will have a musical selection from the Grambling State University Choir under the direction of Mrs. John Ethel Minifield and accompanied by Ms. Patricia Britton. President's going to have to leave us at this moment. But before he goes, we'd like for him to come and just say how much he's enjoyed himself. and let us know when he's coming back.
Let me say, I must say, when I was invited to come back and teach, and I was told all about the food and all the perks of the job, and then the president said he wasn't serious, I was getting into this. I've got a good pension. I can work pretty cheap. Let me say one thing seriously. I very much hate that I have to go back now, but I have, as you know, we've got a lot going on overseas. And it's 6 hours ahead there, and I have to make a lot of phone calls today and do a lot of work. Otherwise, I wouldn't leave. I'd like to stay here till midnight. Not talk till midnight, just stay here till midnight. This has been a wonderful thing for me. I've had a lot more fun than you have so far at this. I cannot thank you. I'm so proud of you. And I like looking out there and seeing your faces and your eyes and your self-confidence. And I want you to go out and do a great job with your lives. Thank you. God bless you.